Pete, I've listened to your videos and I've heard you mention about being on ships of light. Now, with the videos that I'm producing, I'm getting around, and it's kind of backed up by this, that, and the other, and what people have written, but they're talking about structures of light. And I've done this in public places. I've even said, you know, there are structures of light here and there. And then Google goes and makes this game called Ingress, and someone pointed it out to me that they were placing the same structures there, type thing. I couldn't make the stuff up if I tried. But I've, along similar lines, you've talked about being on ships of light. So what I'd like you to do is just explain the process. You, how you got there, what state you think you're in, and what you are in, if you could, please.
Well, this is where it gets very interesting, because in the start of my experiences, like, it's been happening since I was a kid, but I'd say, you know, going back a few years now, when I was on the craft, I know for a fact that sometimes I've been there physically, because I've had marks, you know, scoop marks done and things of that nature. And it's been of a positive nature, to tell you the truth, those types of things. And what I've come to an understanding of is sometimes they'll take you astrally, sometimes they'll take you physically, and sometimes they'll take both parts, because they need to make sure that they resonate together. So sometimes the astral body or whatever may need tuning on an energetic level.
Yeah.
And then because of the changes and things going on, the physical part of you will need it as well. Then when you put the two back together, there's like tweaking that's got to be done. Some of the sort of light being, rainbow beings in Orion, they will take the astral part. And then the lower ones, which are, they're brown greys. I hate using the word greys because they're not grey, they're brown. And they've got more of a head like that. Like, it's not like a typical grey's head, and they've got round black eyes. They work more with the physical realms, and for them, it's easier for them to go between planes and dimensions.
Do you describe them as physical or beings of light?
Those, the brown ones are definitely physical, but the way they've created, from what I'm understanding, and they are consciousness, they've got personalities, there's other ones that don't. But these guys, it's like as if they've been created to go between realms. And it's like any vibration doesn't mess with them too much, where the higher light beings, which are the ones that we're dealing with, the worlds of light, it's a lot of work for them to come down the planes. It depends on energetic environments and things of that nature, and what they're interacting with, on if they can fully come through or whatnot. But every now and then, when I need my butt kicked, they'll come through or pick me up. But it's important to remember here, and I wrote a book, Shiji wrote a book for me called The Book of Shiji, and she's a light being from the star Merope and a gatekeeper in the Pleiades, and she's a light being. Now, she has appeared as physical as, you know, me sitting here in front of you if you were here, and she has appeared as a female, but later she showed me her true nature, which is just like a being of light. I can't put it any other way. Sometimes she almost looks crystalline, like made out of crystal, but it's a white light. And she was explaining to me that everything is one consciousness. That consciousness, once condensed down, goes to light, and then once condensed down again, goes to sound, and once condensed down again, comes to what we know as physical matter. So everything is light, just everything is consciousness. It just depends on which state it's at in terms of if it's light, sound, or matter. But each realm does have its own physicality to it, if you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah.
So in the first stage, the balls went all the way and gathered a bit of physicality.
But each realm does have its own physicality to it, if you understand what I'm saying. With some of the crafts that I've been on, it took me a while to experience to understand my experiences in terms of what was happening. Was I was on there astrally. Because there was one time that I was pulled, and it was during the middle of the day. What I call being pulled is where you're basically ripped from where you are to another place. And I started to meditate, and all of a sudden, I just felt like the environment and everything had changed. And it was not, I've been unbounded before, where I was everything, and it happens occasionally through meditation and experiences. But it wasn't fully unbounded, and I basically opened up my eyes, and there was other white light beings around me that had a tinge of blue to them, and were all in a circle. And what I next realized was What's that, mate?
Were they in a circle around you, interestingly enough? Because a lot
That has happened before with what I call the Elohim. But this was a different experience where I was in a circle with them.
Yeah.
And it was like I was in a saucer-type structure, but it was made out of light.
Yeah.
Now, after some time, everything I knew was way more expanded than the human body computer experience that I've had here. It was like I had past life memories and all this stuff going on.
Yeah.
But what I knew, they knew, and what they knew, I knew. There was a symbiotic relationship between myself and them.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, I was part of the craft. So we're all symbiotic, the craft and the other beings and myself. Now, if I looked at the ground, when I was looking down at the ground, however I was perceiving this, because it was different to human body with the eyes, there was another way I was perceiving this reality. But if I focused on the ground, I would see it as a bluish-white light, but if I somehow defocused how I was perceiving this, I could see through the craft and see the roof of my house during the day, in real time.
Wow.
And then if I defocused, how I don't know how I was observing this.
Yeah, yeah.
That's one thing. And I think that in between states, I know it all, just like you. I think we all know all that is in between states when we connect with a certain part of ourselves.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of this is filtered out due to what we can perceive at this time with the body, if you can understand what I'm saying. So it's like, you don't need to know this at the moment. All you need to know is that this is going on and we're showing you what you need to know at this time.
Yeah, exactly.
So does that sort of make sense? Am I explaining it well enough? Because it's hard to explain.
Yeah, for sure. Exactly. I like the part how you described how you didn't know what state you are in to see that, because you see a lot of the symbology with the third eye, and you can, you know, you can find that in a mural here in Sydney, an installation here in Sydney, where they clearly make that, and they've got these like blue beings in the street. And then down in Melbourne, you've got the eyes also on those guardians that you've got down there. But anyway, so the third eye, with my understanding, and I'll relate through with the kind of ritual process, the magic ritual process, is that from the understanding, they use the elements and they bring themselves up through the chakras. So they bring into the ritual situation the elemental spirits, and they use those to get the etheric chakras, the etheric magnetism of the chakras whirring. And it's a case of bringing up first of all the base chakra and then moving up through the chakras, and it's highly symbolized. But so with your state, though, you're in a state where you it's not your physical body, you're actually in a light body. Would that be right? And you're kind of viewing from a light body. That's what you're saying, isn't it?
Yes.
So strangely enough, you're not seeing with your physical eyes in a way, strange way.
And this is where, like, you're exactly right. There has been times, again, where I have been on there physically.
Yeah.
But that's with the lower type dimensional stuff. But no, you're exactly right. And I had third eye experiences, right, where it's basically sometimes split in two in terms of, I can be filming a craft and I'm on the craft looking down at myself.
Yeah.
And then sometimes, not only that, I'm outside of the craft looking down on the craft looking down at myself.
Right.
And I'm filming the friggin' craft with a conscious connection here.
Yeah.
So this is where it's very important what you're saying, but in saying that, I know people that have had ayahuasca and other things where...
Yeah.
What they do describe is very similar to what I experienced. Now, whether I'm more in tune than others biologically for this connection to happen, whether I produce more DMT in my brain because we all produce it naturally, or however I've been altered or people are connected to this, there is a commonality, because especially when I talk to people having astral experiences or experiences on light crafts and that sort of thing, the HD quality, it's like you're in a freaking HD TV. And this reality is like a 70s television. It's dull.
Yeah.
There's a bit of snowiness to it.
Yeah.
So how I perceive this is different because there's an unboundedness quality to it. I can't explain it any other way.
So the light structure, for example, of, say, a craft, would you describe it as quite clear, quite defined, quite... even the light bodies very highly defined. Would that be a way rather than a...
Yeah, with the being, sometimes it's not. But with the craft, it is. And what's really weird is that if it was something made by us in terms of technology, you'll be friggin' blinded by it.
Yeah.
By the light. But for some reason, I'm able to look at the light. And even with some of the crafts I see with my eyes, and there's no blinding quality to it.
Yeah.
But it's really bright and it's really defined and clear.
Okay. Aside from this conversation, I interviewed Laszlo Novak here in Sydney. Are you aware of Laszlo?
Yeah, I'm in communication with him at the moment, coincidentally. So I've actually, we've exchanged a few messages. I just haven't been able to have time. I just haven't had time lately to connect. But I've got back to him a couple of days ago. So hopefully we're sorting something out.
Great. Yeah, I found it hard to get an interview with Laszlo. He was a bit untrusting, and as you may well know, according to him, kind of screwed around by a few TV crews and bits and pieces. So, this all stems back to the 1990s, the late 1990s and stuff like that. So he kind of lost a bit of trust with, but he turned me down at one stage, and then I was lucky enough to get an interview with him, and you can see the interviews on my channel. He has a similar experience to you, in that what he describes to me is that when the crafts come by, this may not necessarily be all the time, but at times there's kind of a voice in his head, so to speak, that tells him to go outside with his camera. And indeed, I've been there, I've been on his roof, and I've got the film, footage of his cameras and stuff, and he will be up there, and you seem to have the same thing, where you see these crafts, and even with the, as you show, with the craft lighting up, that was down in Melbourne or whatever, it's very impressive, that you're having the same experience. Would that be right?
Yes, it's happening all over the entire world, and it seems to be a component that researchers, UFO researchers, have taken note on, but not really gone any further on. And this shows that there is a conscious aspect to these interactions. You could be waiting all day for them, and it's going to happen when it's going to happen. People think I'm out there hours on end.
Yeah.
You just get a what I call thought transfer.
Yeah.
And you just know to go out, and either straight away or within a minute or two, bang, something goes down.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Interesting that both you and Laszlo have that experience. I've been, into Laszlo's house. He's just had a birthday and all the rest of it, and pity I don't have it. He's got a bit of footage where you can kind of see the outline of a human being. It would be like your outline as I see it now, going through a graveyard of all places. But I've got some other footage of his that I've shown on my video, that he gave to me. One thing I was just going to say is that Laszlo does not have the technology, and he's not the man to, fudge the footage and all the rest of it. There's just no way. I've been to his house and stuff. He's got very basic stuff, and in a way, his cameras are quite basic too. So, yeah.
No, fascinating bloke. So, yeah, I'll hopefully tee that up soon with him as well. I haven't spoken to him. I've seen
congratulations.
A handful of his videos on and off over the couple of years, but that's been all I know about him. I don't know anything about his experiences. So,
oh, really?
It's interesting what you're saying, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow. Another thing about there's another aspect to Laszlo that he was part of the there's a paranormal research society here in Sydney, as I'm sure you've interviewed Craig from that society. Laszlo was part of that. He's not now. I think he got out of it. One of the reasons was that he had a bit of an experience where he was in a particular manor, a house out that way, not thinking of the name right now, and he went back there, he had an experience at 1:15 in the morning, and then he went back there about a couple of months later or something or other, and had a similar experience at 1:15 in the morning, and he had the spirit enter him. He didn't know about the history of a young boy dying near the house, and all the rest of it, and I cover that in my video, but it's very interesting. Anyway, I was speaking about chakras, and this spirit that seemed to enter him, and he got it on camera too. That's what I think happened, because you can kind of see it there and all the timing and all the rest of it. It looks like a little whirlwind. But anyway, that experience, whilst he was there, he described it going up his spine and away, going up the chakra system, it sounded like, sort of igniting that in a particular way. And that's an aspect to Laszlo also, and I don't know, you may talk to him about that. There's probably a lot to talk about, but yeah, just talking about that subject.
No, that's interesting, definitely.
Yeah.
Guys, I feel I feel numb my leg, and I get it. And it's been off needles in my leg. I get it. Guys, I don't know.
Do you have anything else to say about structures of light?
Not that I can think of at this time. Somebody, if you get the chance, there's a bloke called Barry Littleton I've had on my show.
Right.
And he's from America, and I'll tell you what, he's one of the most intelligent and articulate people I've ever met, and he's an experiencer.
Yeah.
He does have a great understanding on a lot of these sort of things.
Yeah.
Myself, all I can do is explain what I've had, you know, either experienced or what knowledge I've had passed down onto me.
Yeah.
And the most complex thing I've had in understanding is things condensed down, like, again, consciousness to light, the sound to matter.
Yeah.
I guess with a lot of this, it's got to do with different vibrations, that it depends on the state, you know, of where these beings are at, and there are different realms, definitely. The most fascinating realms to me are the geometric realms, and the geometric beings in those realms, and they seem to... Also, they're made out of light, but it's different.
Yeah.
But it's something that I'm still trying to understand. And if anything pops up, you'll be the first I'll get in contact with to explain further if anything comes through. If there is anything else, I just can't think of it at the meantime. But
fantastic. From what I can see, and you know, these days things are being depicted within video games of all things. In past times it's been the churches and cathedrals, but I think the tradition's changing, and a lot of it now is in video games and films. But video games, it's amazing. And with the elemental energies, spirits, the elemental spirits, they strangely enough seem to form into geometric, they're called platonic solids. And the Masons show this, and I've got a picture of them, that they present those plutonic solids on the floor. Not only have the Freemasons placed the plutonic solids on the floor, you will notice that they've placed them on the edge of the magic circle. And you can see them at the edge of the magic circle if you look in presentations elsewhere, I would suggest. Anyway, that's just another interesting thing. And of course, if you think of Bill Gates with his windows, that you've got the light in the center with the four colors there, which would represent earth, air, fire, and water, the whole bit. It's really interesting once you start getting into it. But I sort of cover this in my videos. Just with my videos, just for you, I was just saying, I'll just mention that things kicked off with me in 2012, really, with all this. And I was in the Masonic Center, and a guy came up to me, and at the time I was a bit freaked out with the whole thing, to be honest. But we sat down in a pub and stuff for a few hours after that, in a few cafes, and started talking. And as he said, all that time I never mentioned my name. I was like, who is this guy? Do you know what I mean? And because of the stuff that had happened to me, I'd had a bit of download, like, and I just came to a bit of a realization about things in mid-2012. But anyway, I ended up doing an interview with him, and that's on From Other Dimensions Part 1, and then there is a follow-up vid to that, and I'll give you the details to that vid, and you can see how I've compared what he said to what Cirque du Soleil, Circus of the Sun, to what they present in one of their things, and you can see that what he says matches up with what Cirque du Soleil showed. And at the time, he had no idea what, neither did I, as to the full content, you know, that when you look at it more carefully, of what Cirque du Soleil. So it's an amazing, for me, it was an amazing way that I could show how his stuff was aligning with what Cirque du Soleil showed. And Cirque du Soleil play for the, you know, the head magician of the world, you know, of the world, dare I say it, or the queen type thing, who the Masons revere, and you know, so forth and so forth. So, you know, Her Majesty, Mage, and all the rest of it. And as you see with my videos, you've got your magistrate. It all comes down to magnetism, the magistrate who summons the spirits, which is you when you're summoned to court and all the rest of it. But anyway, so...
I love it. It just goes on, doesn't it?
Yeah. So if you get time somewhere, somehow, I would suggest you have a check that out, because it's another aspect to all this.
Yeah, will do. Yeah. Will do.
Yeah.
It'd be good to interview you sometime when I've got a bit more time. We'll catch up again if you want.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. Let's... I can tell you right now, I've only had one outstanding experience with all this, and of all things, it's pretty wild.
Well, I'm finding your research is fascinating too, so
yeah,
keep up the good work.
Yeah, all right, cool, let's do that at a later date.
Yeah, definitely.
All right, cheers, man, for, you know, for having a yak and all the rest of it. I appreciate it. Yeah, I'll see what happens with all this. I'll But hopefully I've got this recorded and stuff. It should be good. appreciate what you're doing, man, because you're really... I like where you're coming from. Do you know what I mean? You're just like... you're not mucking around and all the rest of it. It is what it is and blah, blah, blah. And that's what all this needs. So I congratulate you. I'm impressed.
And thanks for what you're doing. I just hope I've explained it good enough, because it is hard to describe some of the things. I just hope I'm doing the best that I can when I'm describing what I can, because it's just, you're trying to find referencing words for some stuff you just can't.
Yeah.
You know, some things you can, but some things you can't. But I just hope it just did it justice to explain to you what, you know, I was saying, you know, the proper way, I hope.
Actually, just continuing on, I guess, you described a being that has presented to you in light, but also in physicality. Did you say, like, kind of here on Earth, in your home type thing?
Oh, shit, yeah. Yeah, and other people have seen it before too, as clear as day. So it's see-through shit or apparition, it's solid as anything.
Right, so if that person sat down on the sofa... The sofa's going to depress the
And she's even put a hand on my head before, and it was completely cool.
Right. So how did this person appear? Did you walk into the room, or this entity?
No, she appeared in like a blink of an eye, bending over the coffee table, looking at me in my eyes, and she had huge.
Right.
They're like our eyes, but they're like 2-3 times the size, easy.
Right. Who else would have witnessed that?
I've had a few people, my partner's experienced her before, and I've only been with her for about a year. I've been interacting with this being since 2012, around that time. And there's been a couple of other people that have had experiences when they visited,
right,
seeing her, just glimpses and that sort of thing. And people experienced her talking in their head to her. And, you know, I'd be like, did you just hear something? They're like, dude... You know, and then they'll be like, yeah, I just had this, you know, I was like, have you heard a female voice? And they're like, yeah.
Mm.
And they're like, how do you know? And it's like, I'm not, you know, I tell them who it is and what's going on. Then there'll be a sighting of a craft or, you know, something go on. It does depend on where the people are at, and it does depend on their energy signature also, which I've come to understand later on. Because sometimes some of these beings have to use our energy to compensate for them coming down the planes to do whatever they're doing for a certain amount of time. So there is a energy transfer as well.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. That is what is described within magic rituals. What they do within the lodges, as far as I can detect and without going into all that, but what they do is they create what's called an etheric magnetic edifice. So everything within that edifice is highly charged. And then the other thing they do is they put put like incense into the room as well. And for whatever, however they can do it, creatures can use that the incense to sort of gain a bit of physicality to their presence, if you know what I mean. And also another thing you were mentioning with James Gilliland when you were over there, you were mentioning how that area was a soft spot for interdimensional entities, call them what you will, to be there. Now that absolutely resonates with what places like, well, I would suggest even the position of your churches and cathedrals around the world.
Oh yeah.
But also places like Stonehenge, which really are no different, and all the rest of it, and then your Egyptian pyramids, all of that stuff. That's what it's about. And what I suspect, also I have no proof, and I don't know if anyone's really talked about this, but at different times in history on this planet, there have been times when I would suggest that the barriers between the dimensions were thinned virtually for the whole planet. I just privately suspect that, but at this time they're not particularly. That doesn't mean to say, but from what I can detect, it's still the secrets are still kind of maintained, and I've met people who just won't talk, occultists who won't talk, and all the rest of it. For whatever reason, the secrets are being maintained and have been maintained along the lines of real magic practice. And
I'd agree with a lot of that. And I think it's this time that, you know, enough's enough, and slowly these things are just seeping back out. And I think everyone's got a piece of this puzzle.
Yeah.
Whether they realize.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is why we've got to do what we're doing, just network and talk and just share information.
Yeah.
Because there definitely is areas where the veils between worlds are a lot thinner, but I think at one time too, like you're saying, it was like that over the whole joint. And I think it's not just a Earth or solar system thing, because there are energetic things at play with that, but I think on a galactic level and universal level, where, you know, we're actually sitting in cycles as well.
Yeah.
And whoever's behind this, or, you know, it's come to my understanding, on one side you've got an archonic type nature, which once were Elohim type beings. They've got knowledge of the beings under them, whether, you know, it goes reptilian then to overshadowing humans. They've got this knowledge and they've been able to use it for their benefit, which is how they've created an energetic grid and basically blinded, you know, humanity to feed off energetically. And slowly that's, you know, unveiling now to the rest here. You know, though it may seem just out there to some, it's, you know, things are coming to light more than ever.
Yeah, I think so too. Also, do you mind if I use your footage, where particularly the one where you've shown it before, where you're on the beach or somewhere, and that you're saying to people, it's going to light up, and the ship lights up? Are you all cool with that?
Oh, that's fine. Yeah, that was at Mount Buffalo over the Christmas break, that one. Yeah,
right. Yeah. Yeah, there was one that was, you know, it was a very outstanding type thing.
Yeah, you watch what this does. Just watch what this does, alright? Watch this now. Watch it.
Yeah, I'm watching it.
Watch it.
Got it on camera.
James Gilliland, isn't it funny? He captured the same one, a very outstanding one that lit up, and he was, I think he said, do you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, definitely. I used that on the documentary too. It's basically that, you know, it's similar stuff. We call them power ups. You've got satellites that do their flares and that, you know, anybody that comes out with this can tell the difference between the satellites and these. You know, I've even got them blinking out completely in infrared, and there's lots of footage there you can go through. So feel free to just grab whatever you want.
I can't get this guy. Oh, he is. He's powering up. Yes. Whoa, look at that. Look at that. Whoa. Whoa, that was an incredible one.
That was cool.
That was a nice, I got it all on film. I got that one on film. That was a white out your screen moment.
Wow.
Bravo.
Definitely. Bye, brother. Take it easy, mate.
Cheers.
See ya.